Hello and welcome back. Today we're going to be all about the OMIPs. It's a fun word to say, OMIP. For those of you who haven't heard about OMIPs before, they're a wonderful collection of optimized multicolor immunofluorescence panel. That's what OMIP stands for, optimized multicolor immunofluorescence panel. This is a special peer-reviewed type of publication put on by Cytometry Part A that looks at newly designed optimized multicolor panels for flow cytometry. So let's take a look at how these work. I'm just gonna hop on screen share. Perfect. Okay, so I will put the link to all of these down in the description below. So OMIPs, you can find on the Cytometry Part A website, and they are really just a publication that is looking at an optimized panel that a researcher has developed for their work. It sounds pretty simple, which is the goal of it. It's to be a simple resource for you to access, but there's a lot of work and detail that goes into establishing an OMIP. So on here, you can see there's quite an extensive list of OMIPs. I think right now 88 is the highest. This is not the most efficient way of looking through them, but just to give you an idea, there is a very, very long list. So I've pulled one out today, OMIP 69, which is the 40 color full spectrum panel for a deep immunophenotyping of human immune cell subsets from peripheral blood. This is, I guess, the highest parameter OMIP that currently exists, but I thought it would be a good way just to show you what goes into the making of an OMIP. So all of them start the same way. It always starts with a purpose and description of the types of sample types used and what they're identifying it with the panel. Then you get some background as to why this is an important thing to study, like a standard scientific paper would give you. And then you get more into the OMIP details. So the big thing, the star of the OMIP, if you will, is generally the gating strategy. So how all of these fluorochromes are put together in a panel to find the subsets that they're looking to study. Further down in the OMIP, you'll also always find the summary of the application and then the table of the reagents used. And this is really the nice part, is it takes a lot of the heavy lifting out of a panel design. If there is a panel that has an OMIP similarly published, or a OMIP published that is similar to what you want to study, they've essentially done all the heavy lifting for you. You can go in here, it will have the clones, the fluorochrome, and the marker that was used for everything in that OMIP. It's a really nice resource there. Also, we'll link you to other similar OMIPs that may be smaller or more related to what you want to do. But the part that you should always look at with these OMIPs is the supplementary information. That's where really all the nitty-gritty details are. So if we open that guy up, you'll find that the supplementary material is huge in comparison to the actual paper itself. So the paper itself is generally like 2 to 3 pages. You look down here, you can see there are 33 pages of supplementary information, and it goes through everything, all the details that went into setting up this panel. So always starts with the instrument configuration and instrument setup optimization. So how the instrument works, how it was set up and properly working for the panel. It will go through the strategy used. So why certain fluorochromes were picked and how they were characterized and how that all worked together, and some of the basic panel design strategies that went into putting this together. So you can see that here. Generally also include spillover spread matrices, compensation matrices depending on the OMIP, and also what channel was used for what fluorochrome, generally speaking. Also, we'll go through how fluorochromes were paired based on antigen classification co-expression, how viability dyes were selected, all the details that you kind of need to think about when you're planning a panel. Generally, also we'll give titration data. That's a really critical part of an OMIP, is not just designing a panel, but optimizing it so that everything's working at the proper concentrations. And then you'll see it will get into areas where maybe there was an error in a unmixing or a compensation calculation. So how that was corrected, how it looked, and what steps they went into to fix that. Going down, it will also then get into, this is still looking for errors. how the gating was established. So that's where the FMOs generally come in if they weren't already in the gating strategy and how those were set up. And you can see there's just a huge amount of data in these supplementary figures. And even more extensive, comprehensive list with the concentration involved in there. And then finally, the gating strategy just generally expanded out a little bit to make it easier to see. So there you have it. That's kind of your first look at an OMIP if you haven't seen one before. And in the OMIP, they will also give a very detailed staining protocol. So not only can you follow the panel, but also the exact protocol that was used. So going through these OMIPs one by one to find something that works for you if you're in more of a generalized area or need to kind of look through a few to find something that works for you can be fairly arduous. So there is a group that's put together a really great OMIP resource that can be found on the ISAC website. So ISAC is the International Society for the Advancement of Cytometry. And under their publications, you can link to the OMIP Cytometry Part A database, which takes you, let's get back to the main page, to this. And it is an in-depth way of looking through OMIPs to more easily find what you want to find. So we'll go through each one by one. So if you want to search a specific OMIP and you know which one that is, you can do that here. That's what this first page is for. So if we want to look at, oh, I was wrong, we're up to 90. So if we want to look at OMIP, I don't know, 80, it will automatically update and show us OMIP 80 here. So if you want a really quick resource and you know which OMIP you're looking for, that's what the first tables or first tab is for. The reagent table, say you are interested in, I don't know, what's your favorite marker? Let's go with CD86 as a random one. So we'll check that and this will give us all the OMIPs that use CD86 and we can see what they react against. So if we're looking for a rat OMIP with CD86, we'd be looking at OMIP 41, or the humans ones, we can look at any of these three here. So if there's a marker or a combination of markers that you want to look at, or if you know a specific clone, that's where you would search this. Sample type is looking at the different species that OMIPs are derived from. So if you're, say, working on cow, you can click on that one and you can find the cow immunophenotyping panels. Obviously, if you're going into mice, there's going to be a lot more than with cows. Again, sample search type result, same sort of idea. You can search for whatever you want in here. I don't generally use that one. Search text is really cool. If you want to quickly find some generic information, you can type it in here. So same thing if we went CD86. It will pull up the OMIPs, and if we click on one of them, it will automatically take us back to this table where we can see all the details from that OMIP. Protocol, again, we'll link to the protocol. So there's a specific protocol you want to know. You can find it here, or say if we're going back to the same OMIP 41 that we've been looking at all along, it will pull up the exact protocol that was used in that OMIP for us. And the part that I find really cool is this population tab. So if you're looking to classify a certain type of cells and not sure which OMIP you should be looking at and you don't want to dig through the whole list, this is the place I would recommend you start. So say, for example, I want to study macrophages. I can go in here and type in macrophage and select it on the list. And if I want M1 and M2, I can check those off as well. Too fast. And over here, you can now see these are the OMIPs that specifically list that they work with macrophages or M1 and M2 macrophages as major populations. So if I then wanted to study these or take some work out of making my panel, I can go look at these OMIPs and use that to create my panel. So there you have it, a quick tour of OMIPs, why you should care about them, how you would use them. And I really recommend when you get into your panel design to take a close look at these. They've gone through and optimized things like fluorochrome overlap. They've optimized clone selection. So it can take a lot of guesswork out of your panel design if you're starting on a new project, or even if you're looking to optimize what you're already doing. And with that, I'll see you in the next one.